Hello, namaste and good afternoon to all of you who are joined with us today. Thank you all for finding time and visiting today's webinar. I am your host for the day and my name is Shubham Badola. Our today's topic is Ostracott distribution and their implication on microenvironment, and the speaker is Professor M.S. Hussain. Before we start, let me explain how you can talk to us during the presentation. Just write the question to the chat in YouTube. We will have question and answer session at the end of to answer your questions. We will send attendance and feedback link during the webinar in YouTube comment section with time limit, so carefully fill the form. Now I would like to call President of Jio Vigyan, Mr. Ajay Rautela, to please say few words. Ajay sir.
Thank you, Shubham. Hello everyone, and a hearty welcome to all our participants hailing from different time zones around the world. I am Ajay Rautela, President of Jio Vigyan. In last 2 months, we organized 2 international level quizzes. After the successful completion of 2 international level quizzes, now Team Jio Vigyan organized an international webinar series on earth science, and today is our third talk of this webinar series. Today we are so happy to have with us Professor S.M. Hussain, the very known micropaleontologist, who is currently a professor and head Department of Geology, University of Madras, India. We thank Professor Hussain for accepting our invitation for the talk. And we also thank all the participants for showing interest and support in our initiative. So now, on the behalf of Jio Vigyan, I would like to welcome you all in our third talk of this webinar series. I will now request Mr. Shubham, please introduce our guest. Over to you, Shubham.
Thank you, Ajay sir. Now we can begin. Our today's speaker is Professor M.S. Hussain, who is a renowned person in the field of earth science and especially in micropaleontology. Although we will need a whole session to tell about him and his achievements, but due to time limit, I would like to give you a short introduction. He did his PhD in 1992, MPhil in 1987, and MSc in 1986 in geology from University of Madras. He is working as a professor and head in Department of Geology in University of Madras. He has 30 years of teaching and 32 years of research experience. He has research experience in the field of micropaleontology. He has established 6 ostracott new species, and they are included and incorporated in the International Ostracott Catalog published by American Museum of Natural History, USA. He has done extensive research work on recent ostracott of marine and marginal in Tamil Nadu coast, and also in finding out signatures for possible paleo-tsunami deposits from the coast of Tamil Nadu and Andaman Island. He has published 93 papers, of which 62 are in national and 31 are in international journals, 11 book chapters, and also authored 1 book. He has completed 6 national funding research projects by different big organizations like CSIR, DST, UGC, Ministry of Earth Science, etc. In India. He has been elected as Life Fellow of the Academy of Science, Chennai, Paleontological Society of India, Lucknow, Geological Society of India, Bangalore, Gondwana Geological Society, Nagpur, Indian Association of Sedimentologists, Aligarh, Member of Society of Earth Scientists, Lucknow, and Association of Geoscientists for International Development. He has participated and presented papers not only in India, but also in Mexico, Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Sri Lanka, and Dhaka, in total of 79 seminars. Besides this, he has also organized 15 national seminars and workshops. He has received Distinguished Scientist Award from Venus International Foundation Research, Chennai, in December 2015. He has also received Best Researcher Award from EET CRS Science and Technology, New Delhi, in June 2017. Now, without further ado, I will turn the time to you, sir. Professor, please, sir, present here.
Yeah. So, good afternoon to all. And at the outset, I thank Mr. Ajay for having given me this opportunity, and I thank Mr. Shubham for his nice introduction about me, and Garima Shukla is also there, and I'll directly go to my presentation. So once again, A very good afternoon to all the participants. So the title of my talk is Distribution and Significance of Benthic Ostracoda and Their Implications on Microenvironment. And International Fossil Day is falling in the next week. That is, some people are telling it is on 14 and some are telling on 16. And that is why many universities in India, they are celebrating the Fossil Day, International Fossil Day. In the coming week, the entire week, they are arranging, celebrating the Fossil Day in the form of organizing few special lectures on fossils, megafossils as well as microfossils. And it is being celebrated. And on this occasion, and Mr. Ajay has requested me to give a talk on importance of fossil ostracods and their significance in the environment. So I'm going to give you an insight, what are ostracods and how they are helpful in the environmental studies, as well as in identifying the hydrocarbon deposits. I'm going to give you an insight. Before that, I just would like to tell you few landmarks in the history of the earth, how the earth is changed to the present state, and some of these significant landforms in the form of some major geological events, and some appearance and disappearance of the fossils, the life on the earth. So to begin with, many of us know that our Mother Earth is originated 4,600 million years ago. It can also be called as Mega Annum, 4,600 million years. And the solar system, the Earth, Moon, other planets, the solar system has formed during that time. And the Earth's magnetic field also formed during the same period almost. And 3,500 million years ago, the first permanent crust got crustified. Prior to that, it was in a liquid state, semi-solid state. And the crust formation has taken place about 3,500 million years ago. And 3,500 million years ago, the atmosphere is also formed, but with carbon dioxide, more amount of carbon dioxide, and the seawater also formed during that time. And 3,000 million years to 2,500 million years ago, and oldest sedimentary rocks, the layered rocks started forming. And this is the time around 2,500 million years ago. And in the atmosphere, the free oxygen, sufficient amount of oxygen started appearing. That is the reason why 2,500 million years is considered as period of oxygen revolution. Due to the appearance of the oxygen in the atmosphere, the life started appearing on the earth. Prior to that, you don't have the life. The origin of the life can be dated back 2,500 million years plus or minus 200 million years. So during that time, because of the presence of the initial forms like prokaryotes, algae, fungi, bacteria, and these started flourishing in their distribution, and photosynthetic activity has taken place. Then 2,300 million years, first large scale glaciation on the earth has taken place. Then after that, 2,000 to 1,000 million years ago, the microcontinents, they were there, they started accretion of these microcontinents has taken place, and the formation of Rudinia, supercontinent in the initial stage. And then about 700 to 600 million years ago, major glaciation, it has taken place affecting every continent. Then around 600 million years ago, first appearance of soft-bodied multicellular organisms. These we call them as eukaryotes. The appearance of the eukaryotic organisms has taken place about 570 to 600 million years ago. And about 550 million years ago, worldwide emergence of marine animals with shells and skeletons, algal colonies, they started declining, algal forms, they started declining. And 480 million years ago, first freshwater fish and plants, they have appeared. So this fish, this particular period abundance of the fish appeared on the the aquatic environment. That is why it is called as age of fishes. And 420 million years ago, first land plants. And these are the land plants, the vegetation, which is the main reason for the Cambrian, Carboniferous coal, thermocarboniferous coal, which we are enjoying today, is the main reason for because of the presence of these first land plants and thick vegetation. And around 400 million years ago, the age of fishes, so more or less the same time, the dominance of the fishes has taken place. Then 250 million years ago, the mass extinction of marine life has taken place. So as a whole, if you see in the history of the earth, there were five times major mass extinctions have taken place, though this is considered as one of the major mass extinctions. And 270 million years ago, then the supercontinent which has formed, which we call it as Pangaea, and it started stretching, and many continents they formed in warm arid climate, and Asian microcontinents begin to move away from Australia and Gondwana land. And 220 million years ago, the dinosaurs developed from, if you see the evolution of the life, and initially you have the brachiopods, then pelecypods, gastropods, cephalopods, and you have the ammon, of course, you have other cephalopods, then coelenterates, corals, echinoderms, and then you have the started getting the appearance of the fishes, and then amphibians, then reptiles, and from reptiles, and it got evolved into birds, aves. So these dinosaurs started appearing in the early Triassic time, and from chicodont reptiles, and also earliest birds also started appearing slowly in this time. And 210 to 145 million years ago, the dinosaurs were dominant. This is the time we call it as Jurassic period, and the birds also spread. And about 180 million years ago, Africa and South America started begin to stretch apart, thereby splitting apart from North America, thereby the appearance of the origin of the Central Atlantic Ocean. So this Indian Ocean and the Atlantic Ocean started opening up origin into the Jurassic time. 150 million years ago, Rocky Mountain orogenic activity has taken place, Rockies. And 145 to 160 million years ago, the massive flood basalts erupted through gaping fissures in western central India, and the dinosaurs were dominated land. And the flowering plants and the angiosperms, they got emerged. And 120 million years, India started splitting apart from Africa and Antarctica. It started moving in the northeasterly direction, and then Australia split from Gondwana land and got separated from that. And 65 million years, the mass extinction, this 65 million years major mass extinction is considered as one of the latest mass extinctions out of the five major mass extinctions that have taken place in the history of the earth. So this period is known as the Cretaceous Tertiary mass extinction, 65 million years ago. So marine and land life that disappeared, and particularly the dinosaurs, which were the dominant creatures, the dominant organisms on the land, they disappeared, and they totally became wiped out. It means they got extinct. So if you see the life ever since its origin, and some of the organisms, they originated in the dated back in history and continue to live even in the present time, those forms we call them as extant organisms. The forms which appeared in the geological past and disappeared in the geological past, we call them as extinct forms, extinct and extant. So dinosaurs are the extinct forms, and at the same time, more or less same time, ammonites, which were present in the marine environment, they also got disappeared during this Cretaceous Tertiary mass extinction. Then about 50 million years ago, grasses emerged on the land, and because of the presence of the good amount of grass on the land, the grazing animals, monkeys, they started flourishing. Their population flourished. And this is the period where you have got the good life of horses and then elephants, etc. And 35 million years ago, first apes emerged. And 30 million years ago, the Japanese island split from Asia, which led to the opening of the Japanese Sea. So if anybody asks what is the age of the Japanese Sea, then you can tell the 30 million years ago. Similarly, the age of Atlantic Ocean and Indian Ocean is the Jurassic time. Jurassic time is more or less 210 million years. So 25 million years ago, northern North Atlantic opens up between Greenland and northern Europe. Then Africa moves north to close the Tethys Sea. The African continent moves north further to close the Tethys Sea and collide with the Europe. And 20 to 15 million years ago, the Alpine orogeny has taken place, the Alps. Then 20 million years ago, India begin to collide with Asia, initiating the beginning of the mightiest and youngest Himalayan mountain chains, which is the Himalayas. And 11 to 10 million years ago, great apes, hominids, and human-like organisms got separated. And 3 million years ago, Antarctica got isolated. South America moves away. The last piece of Gondwana land break apart, and climate got cooled dramatically. And the first hominids, the Australopithecus, which were found in the caves of Africa, they were recorded from the at the 3 million years ago. Then 2 million years ago, there was a major glaciation. And from this period onwards, you start getting the glacial interglacial periods. And 1 million year ago, Homo erectus dispersed from Africa to China, Java, that is Indonesia. And 5 lakh years ago, the man appears in Africa and migrates to other continents, Europe and other places. 250,000 years ago, that modern humans, they emerged and they were dominant. They started controlling the entire life on the earth. After the peak of last glaciation, 18,000 years ago, that we call it as last glacial maxima, LGM, and man reached to the every continent. So this is with regard to the brief history of the earth, how it got evolved in terms of the orogenic activity, in terms of the life, the appearance and disappearance of the life. Now, as I told you, the origin of the life dates back to 2500 million years, plus or minus 200 million years. And from that till now, the entire life is being broadly divided into two categories. One is the life of the past and the life of the present. The past life we study in the form of paleontology, that is, paleo means ancient, ontos means life, logos means science. The science of ancient life that is being studied through the fossils. Whereas the present life means the live organisms, whether it may be a plant or it may be an animal or it may be a microbe. So the present life, which we call it as neontology. Neo means existing, new, ontos means life, logos means science. Science of existing life, neontology. We are not bothered about these things because to study the plants, existing plants, botanists are there. To study the existing animals, zoologists are there. To study the existing microbes like bacteria, fungi, virus, all these things, the microbiologists are there. But we, the paleontologists, we are mainly bothered about the ancient life, how the life has originated, how it got evolved, what are the various modifications the organisms have undergone. So in order to study all those things, as a paleontologist, we have to depend upon fossils. The study of fossils is known as paleontology. This paleontology is again broadly divided into two categories. One is the study of ancient plant life, which we call it as paleobotany. In this category, the plant-related microorganisms, microfossils, which we call them as palynology. Palynology or palynomorphs are nothing but the organisms, the fossil organisms which are derived from the plants, which are derived from the plants, like your spores and pollen grains, agritars, chitinozoans, dinoflagellates, all these, and then other kinds of micro, and these palynomorphs, they will have the size range from 10 to 200 microns only. So those are all called as palynomorphs. So they are all derived from the, derived from the plant remains. Then come to paleozoology. Paleozoology is nothing but the life, the fossils of animals. As I told you earlier, invertebrate, it is being divided into three categories. One is invertebrate, vertebrate, and micropaleontology. Invertebrate fossils like Brachiopoda, Pelecypoda, Gastropoda, Cephalopoda, Echinodermata, Coelenterata, Hemichordates, all these come under invertebrate forms. The invertebrate fossils means the fossils without any vertebral column. And then another category is vertebrate fossils. Vertebrate fossils means the fossils which have the vertebral column. So like your fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds, mammals, they're all the vertebrate fossils. And then in paleontology, now there is another important branch of science is known as micropaleontology. This has got more significance nowadays when compared to megapaleontology, because it has got several advantages, several applications. So micropaleontology is nothing but the study of fossils which are very tiny in size, micro in size. So that is why they are called as micropaleontology. All these microfossils or all these megafossils, they have got their own habitat and habits. Now, as I told you, the Earth's history is, Earth's time scale is broadly divided into different time units. The larger time units, which we call them as eons, and there are four eons in the as far as Earth's time scale is concerned: Archean eon, Proterozoic eon, and Phanerozoic eon. Three eons are there, and Archean eon, it starts with Hadean. And if anybody asks what is the time scale, time period of Earth, you can tell that Hadean to Holocene. So Hadean, Archean eon, the time span is 4,600 million years to 2,500 million years. After that, you have got the younger time unit, younger time rocks, which we divide them into Proterozoic eon, which we call them as Proterozoic eon. This Proterozoic eon is having Paleoproterozoic eon, Mesoproterozoic eon, Neoproterozoic eon. And these are represented by the rocks like your Kadapa supergroup of rocks, and which are seen in Andhra Pradesh, Kadapa district, and their equivalent in different places, Pakals in Andhra Pradesh, Badami and Kaladgis in Karnataka. And the younger Proterozoic, that is Mesoproterozoic, or Karnool supergroup of rocks. And these rocks are lying above the Kadapa supergroup of rocks in the Kadapa basin. And above that, you have the Meso to Neoproterozoic rocks, Vindhyan basin. Vindhyan rocks are there in Madhya Pradesh. So, and their Vindhyan's equivalent is seen in Karnataka, that is called as Bhima basin, Bhima rocks. And after these Proterozoic rocks, the time span is 2500 to 570 million years. And from 570 million years onwards, and till today, that period is known as Phanerozoic eon. This Phanerozoic eon is divided into three eras: Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Cenozoic era, 570 to till date. And this Paleozoic era, which is the oldest era of Phanerozoic eon, is divided into different periods like Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, Devonian, Carboniferous, and Permian periods. The time span of this Paleozoic era is 570 to 245 million years. And above that, you have got the rocks. You have got the time, which is called as Mesozoic era. This Mesozoic era is divided into Triassic period, Jurassic period, and Cretaceous period. As far as its time span is concerned, 245 to 65 million years. and then above that you have the Cenozoic era. The Cenozoic era is divided into two periods. One is tertiary period, other one is quaternary period. So its time span is 65 million years to 2.5 million years, this Cenozoic era, and tertiary period, and quaternary period time span is 2.5 million years to till date. So the tertiary period is divided into two units. One is Paleogene, another one is Neogene. Paleogene is having periods like Paleocene, Eocene, Epoch, Paleogene is divided into Paleocene Epoch, Eocene Epoch and Oligocene Epoch. And Neogene is having two divisions, one is Miocene and Pliocene Epochs. And above that you have the youngest time unit or youngest rocks, which we call them as quaternary rocks. And they are Pleistocene and Holocene Epoch. The time span is 2.5 million years to till date. And as I told you earlier, initially you have got the prokaryotic organisms like bacteria, fungi, algae, etc. And then you start getting the eukaryotic forms. And eukaryotic forms, all these different invertebrate forms which I have already explained to you. And then further vertebrate fossils, you have the fishes, amphibians, reptiles, apes, mammals. And during that time, you have the elephants, horse, homo sapiens, and different plant fossils, non-vascular plants and vascular plants, non-flowering and flowering plants, like that they are there. And then, now come to what is, I have organized my lecture in such a way that all the students, they should be able to follow and understand in a better way, in a simpler way. So let me explain you initially the basic things, the fundamental things, then afterwards I'll go in detail into the what is meant by arthropods, how they look like, what are their applications. Then what is a fossil? Fossil is nothing but it's a remain of organisms or remnant of the organisms which lived in the geological past and which are being present, which are being deposited, and their remnants or the remains are generally being appeared in the sedimentary rocks, preferably, and not only in the sedimentary rocks, sometimes in the permafrost, in the ice. In the ice also, some of the organisms are being preserved as fossils, like your mammoths, woolly mammoths. And also, sometimes these insects, you know, they get trapped in the amber or resins of the plants. So, fossil, not only in the sedimentary rocks, and also in the permafrost or in the tree resins and this thing, it will be available. And what are the conditions that are required for the better preservation of the fossilization? So the organism, the dead organism, preferably if it is having hard part, it will have a better chance for the preservation of fossil rather than the soft parts. Of course, soft parts also sometimes it will be preserved as a fossil, but when compared to these two, hard parts have got better chances of preserving as fossils. It is understood, it is estimated generally, out of the 10,000 dead animals, dead organisms, one or two will be fossilized. Rest will be disintegrated, decomposed, disaggregated. So this is how it takes place. Why? Because in the taphonomical processes or in the fossilization processes, lot of natural agencies will act upon it. Natural agencies like water, wind, glaciers, ice, etc. Other activities will take place and they destroy the dead animal. And so when congenial conditions are there, the organism will be preserved as a fossil. So out of the approximate 10,000 dead organisms, one or two will be fossilized. So one condition, better condition is hard parts are generally having preference over the soft parts. And then the dead organism should be immediately being buried. Immediately burial is needed. It's a needy condition. Why? Because if it is not buried immediately by the sediments, then it will be exposed to the atmosphere. Because of that, lot of disintegration takes place, decomposition takes place, and other kinds of natural agency destroy takes place. And another important condition is aquatic environment. Excuse me. Aquatic environment. Aquatic environment means the organism which are died out and deposited in the water related, either in the river or in the lake or in the pond or in the marine environment, they will have better chance of preservation as fossil, which are being died out on the terrestrial or continental environment. Then shell composition also plays a role. And sometimes these organisms, they will have the calcareous composition. Among the calcareous, some of the forms will have aragonitic composition. Aragonite is more susceptible for the decomposition, whereas calcitic forms, they will be preserved in a better way. Then these fossils are of different types, like your body fossil, chemical fossil, Riemanni fossil, reworked fossil, like that different fossils are there. Among these, body fossil is nothing but a fossil which is being preserved entirely, including the soft parts, and that is considered as a body fossil. For example, the woolly mammoth, see here you can see the photograph, woolly mammoth, which are being Siberian permafrost, Alaska permafrost, the ice, they were dominant, these elephants, woolly mammoth, they were dominant during that time there, and they got died out because of the peak glaciation, and they died out and they preserved as a fossil in the ice. And to the extent that the last meal it has consumed, it is also being preserved in the intestine of these body fossils. And then trace fossil. Trace fossil is nothing but, it's a fossil, of course, but it is not a real organism. It is only the trace that is being left behind by the existence of the organism in the geological past, in the form of tracks, trails, burrows, casts, excreta, fecal pallets, etc. So these are all known as tracks, trace fossils, which also we call them as ichnofossils. The study of trace fossils is known as ichnology. Wherever you have got in a sedimentary terrain, if you don't get any kind of invertebrate or any kind of vertebrate fossil or whatever the fossil may be, then you have to search for these trace fossils, and these trace fossils will give you a lot of information with regard to the sedimentary environment of the geological past. Then you have the molds and casts. These are also the impressions, and the organism after its death, you know, because of the acidic water, the external shell will be removed, but its impression, its internal impression, external impression will be preserved in the form of casts and molds. And distillation. Here what happens is, say for example, plants and other kinds of fishes are there. See here, in the process of its fossilization, the other inorganic material will be removed, and more accumulation of the organic component like carbon will be enriched, and because of this organic enrichment, the organic carbon enrichment, the impression of the fossils material will be preserved as a form of carbonization, that is known as plants and other things, they preserved as fossils. So this is a Eocene fish fossil, beautifully preserved. I told you, the insects which are being trapped in the amber, and the insect which is getting trapped in the sediments, soft sediment and amber, and the plant fossils, the process of fossilization is carbonization. And there is another important preservation is the petrification. And in the process of its preservation, the silica material replaces the organic matter of the organism, particularly the vegetative matter, the trees, and grain by grain replacement takes place without disturbing or destructing the organic structure of the dead matter. So this process is known as petrification, and the silica involves in that, and the best example is petrified wood. These petrified wood are present at different places in India, like your Satanur, Thirukkarai in Tamil Nadu, and Akkal fossil wood in Rajasthan. And Archaeopteryx is a fossil which is having a link between the birds and dinosaurs. Dinosaurs, they are the reptiles, they got evolved into the apes, birds. And this particular Archaeopteryx fossil, it has got the morphological characters of both the dinosaurs as well as birds. So that is why Archaeopteryx is considered as a linking fossil between birds and dinosaurs. So I told you, the petrification, petrified wood. Satanur, a place in the Arielur, near Perambalur district. So 18 meters length petrified wood is seen, which is having the age of 100 million years ago. the GSA people have discovered. So this has become a tourist spot. So the, this is a figure tells you the when the earth is originated, what are the different eons, what are the different time periods, what are the different life appearance and the mountain building activities. So Appalachian mountain taken place at the Permian time, early Permian time, Rocky Mountains and the Alpine Mountain and Himalayas. Himalayas are the younger mountain chains. So like that Sierra Nevada and the, all this. So this particular figure tells you the not only the orogenic activity but the appearance of the fossils and disappearance of the fossils, which I have already been explained to you. So all these organisms, whether it is a micro or mega, they have got the habits. These habits are of two kinds, particularly the aquatic habits. They are of two kinds. One is planktonic and another one is benthic. Planktons are the one, the organisms which live in the water column, and they are the free floaters, and they live particularly in the top 200 meters of sea water or marine water or any kind of aquatic environment. So the like your dreidel area, silicoflagellates, diatoms and planktonic foraminifera. And these planktonic forms, particularly the microplanktonic, the microfossils planktonic forms, they have got a short range in time. That is the reason why they serve as good index fossils and they are very much helpful in the biostratigraphical applications. Whereas benthic forms means the forms which are living in the bottom of the water at the sea surface. And their bottom dwelling forms, some are moving, they are the vegetal forms. And some are attached forms, sessile forms. So you have, since they live in the water, above the water, they are linked to the depth, sediment type in which they are lived and other kinds of physicochemical parameters. And since because they are linked to these particular physical and chemical parameters, they are very much helpful in knowing the paleo environments. And these planktonic forms, micro fossils, they are very much helpful in the age determination, that is biostratigraphical applications. And then in short, all these megafossils are some of the microfossils. They have got different applications. Say for example, and the applications like biological studies, biological applications like extinct organisms. In order to know the extinct organisms, and these fossils will be helpful. Had these fossils of dinosaurs are not known, are not found, we would not have come to know about the existence of dinosaurs in the geological past. Similarly, ammonites, similarly graptolites, similarly trilobites. So all these are extinct forms, but these fossils will tell us about their extinction. Similarly, the evolution of the organism, a group of organisms can be clearly studied with the help of the fossils. Say for example, I'll give you an example, horses. Horses appeared in the Eocene period, dates back to 50-55 million years, and they got evolved. And finally, you have got the present day horse, which we call it as equus. And the initial horse is Eohippus or Hyracotherium. So from Eohippus to Merychippus, Myohippus, Parahippus, and then equus, Pliohippus and equus. So like that, different stages, different time periods, they got evolved. The evolution, the clear evolution of a group of organisms, mega organisms, can be very well studied with the help of the fossil. If the fossils are not there, and we cannot tell the clear evolution of the fossils. Eohippus, for that matter, it was very small in size, to the size of a fox. And later on, it got into the size of a wolf. And later on, it got the size is increased to the pony size. And then present horse size is evolved. So like that, various other morphological characters are also there. And people, paleontologists, what they do is, they collect the fossils of different ages. And they keep these fossils of different ages in the laboratory. And they reconstruct how they got evolved. The reconstruction of the evolution of a group of organisms, and by collecting the fossils of different ages, and thereby the evolution can be established. And similarly, in the taxonomical studies means, for example, the trilobites, they belong to the phylum Arthropoda. And when you deal the taxonomy of Arthropoda, taxonomy is nothing but the systematic study of a group of organisms. When you study systematically the arthropod fossils, if you don't take into consideration of these extinct trilobites, then the taxonomy of your arthropoda becomes incomplete. And that is the reason why you have to, in giving the taxonomy of a complete, full taxonomy of a particular group of organism, fossils are helpful. Similarly, one more example is, when you deal the taxonomy of phylum Mollusca, if you don't take into the subclass ammonites, ammonites are not known now, they are not present now. And if you don't take the taxon, the fossil ammonites, and the taxonomy of Mollusca becomes incomplete. So that is why in the taxonomical application, all those are called as biological application of fossils. When you come to the ecological, paleoecological and paleoenvironmental applications, and these organisms, they have got different niche. They live, some are living in the freshwater, and some lived in the brackish water, and some in the marine water, and within the marine water, shallow marine to deep marine, like that. So they give you an information, these fossil forms give you an information with regard to the paleoenvironmental conditions in which they live. Say for example, I will explain to you with the help of two examples. Corals. Corals generally, they live in tropical environment and shallow marine environment. Shallow marine, tropical environment. So if you see 20 degree south to 20 degree north, preferably the corals are dominant. That is in the equator to 20 degree south, 20 degree north. So that is the way, because here this is the tropical environment, tropical warm environment. But the fossils of corals are found in the sediments of Antarctica. What it indicates? Antarctica was once a warm continent. Later on, it got drifted, slowly moved apart and gone to the South Pole. Now it is a cold continent. But in the geological past, when it was attached with the Gondwana land, it was a warm continent. It was very close to the, little bit close to the equator. So during that time, the corals were present in the sediments of Antarctica. And after that, you know, in the due course of time, the Antarctica slowly moved, and finally, it is now in the southern pole, south pole. So like that, see, these fossils will tell you about the paleo environment. And similarly, echinoids are generally, they thrive more in the unturbid environment. The water condition should be unturbid. If the turbidity is there, these echinoids, they cannot survive. Why? Because the echinoids will have the ambulacral and internal ambulacral plates will be there. They should be moved freely. If the water is highly turbid, you know, the turbid water, the clay or silt particles go and clogs the movement of ambulacral and interambulacral plates. So thereby the animal dies. So if you get more of echinoid fossils in a sedimentary environment, it indicates that the water in which those echinoids or those sediments, it was an unturbid water. And similarly, the brachiopods. Brachiopods are the exclusively marine and benthic forms. Benthic means attached forms. In order to attach themselves in the sediments of a marine environment, they need a quiet water, calm water. If the water is highly agitated, turbulent, these brachiopods, the sessile brachiopods, they cannot live. So in order to have their better preserve, better distribution, better occurrence, the water should be quiet and calm. So when you get more of a brachiopod fossil in the sediments, either it may be a subsurface sediment or a outcrop, there you can directly say, without identifying the brachiopoda fossil, blindly you can say, when you get the brachiopods, you can say that the sediments are deposited in a marine environment, shallow marine environment, and the water was a quiet water, like that. This type of implications, this type of interpretations, you can blindly say, you can blindly give with the help of the occurrence of these fossils. And when you come to the biostratigraphy and age applications, as I told you earlier, some of the forms are long ranging, they will not be much helpful in the age identification, and some of the forms are short range, very narrow range, they lived for a short span of time and distributed throughout the world waters. Those forms are called as index fossils. And with the help of these distribution of these index fossils, that is first appearance datum and then last appearance datum, based upon that, the biozones are established. These biozones will represent a particular time period. So by that, with the help of these biozones, we can identify the age of the sediments, age implications, and paleo sea level fluctuation. You know very well that the sea is not constant, it is a dynamic. At one point of time it was at a high level, and at one point of time it is at a low level. The fluctuation takes place, sea level fluctuation takes place. When the sea level is rise, you know, these marine organisms, they live up to that period, that particular coastal period. And later on, in due course of time, when the sea level falls, and you get after a particular time period, the sea level falls, these marine organisms, they go and they present in the bottom, falling sea level coastline. And you can, by identifying these fossils and by identifying the age of these things, you can deduce when the sea level was rise, erosion, and when the sea level has fallen. So like that, you know, sea level fluctuation interpretations can be made. Similarly, paleo monsoonal interpretations can be done, particularly the foraminifera, by their coiling pattern, and then initial chamber, proloculus, and size of the test, by calculating these proloculus and the size of foraminiferal test and other thing. This type of thing are useful in order to find out the paleo monsoonal interpretations. Not only that, globoquadrina pachyderma and globoquadrina detritori and globigerina minardi, I mean globorotalia minardi, there are certain important planktonic foraminifers are there, and these forms will give you an information with regard to the cold water and warm water. Dextral coiling and sinistral coiling of these particular foraminifera will give you an information with regard to the warm water environment and cold water environment. Similarly, in the geological past, the tsunami has occurred, the storms have occurred, and these tsunami and storms, they have brought a lot of marine sediments onto the land. By studying the fossil content, in those on land tsunami sediments, we can find out the paleo storm and tsunami deposits. And by dating those rocks, those sediments, we can tell when this particular tsunami has occurred and when that particular storm has occurred, and we can find out. So the recurrence interval also we can infer. And then pollution monitoring. Pollution can be very well monitored. Particularly, the industries are located along the banks of the rivers as well as coastline. And these industry people, they discharge their effluents into the aquatic environment, either in the rivers or in the sea. They periodically discharge their effluents. And sometimes they treat the effluents, sometimes untreated effluents are being discharged into the aquatic environment. When these aquatic environment is being polluted by the untreated effluents, the aquatic life, the sea fish, shrimps, crabs, prawns, and other kinds of microorganisms, foraminifera, ostracoda, other kinds of forms, their biodiversity changes. And sometimes not only the biodiversity, the morphological characters alters. So just by studying these the sediments of collected from a very close to the coast, now by not only the surface sediments, by collecting the core samples, and by studying the biodiversity of a particular group of organisms, and by geochemically analyzing the test or shells, we can find out what kind of pollutants have come from the industries and how the pollution has taken place. And also by analyzing the age, lead tutan dating and other thing, we can tell how many hundreds of years ago, how many tens of years ago this pollution was there, when it was more, when it was less. Like that we can infer. And sediment deposition and transportation. And these rivers, major rivers, they bring lot of sediment, terrestrial, continental sediments. They debouch these sediments into the sea. How these sediments are being deposited and how they are being transported, that also can be very well studied with the help of not only the megafossils and microfossils. Some of the applications in this are microfossils are there. Okay, so like your paleo monsoon, paleo storm, pollution, here microfossils will play a major role than the megafossils. And when these rivers, you know, mighty rivers like Ganges, Brahmaputra, when they bring, you know, the fan-like sediments, the fan-like type of things are bent fan, like that, you know, it forms. And what is the distance to which they are being traveled they are being transported, all these things can be studied. And then finally, the commercial application of application of fossils, particularly in the coal identification. Certain plant fossils are helpful in identifying the coal deposits, and the hydrocarbon deposits can be identified by studying the paleo environment of the sediments, and also by identifying the age of the sediments with the help of the microfossils. Thereby, we can identify the hydrocarbon deposits. These are in brief about the applications of megafossil as well as microfossils. I told you that the paleo environment, how we identify the paleo environment, unless and otherwise we have the ecological database. Ecology is nothing but the science of the organisms and its related environmental conditions. That is known as ecology. Paleoecology means the science of fossil forms and their paleo environment. That is known as paleoecology. How do you deduce, how do you get paleoecological information? Just by projecting backwards. Whatever the present data is there and present ecological database is there, and you have to correlate with the fossil forms. And that is, present is key to the past, based upon the principle of uniformitarianism. So paleoecology interpretation is based on present day pattern of sedimentation, chemical cycling, circulation, water mass dynamics of the ocean as they relate to the organisms. Say for example, you have the present day living organisms are there. With these organisms, the fossil forms, the forms are lived, you know. So whatever the data, ecological database is there, that can be correlated to the fossil forms, and thereby you can deduce the paleoecology. And similarly, as I told you, biostratigraphy, one form, when it is first appeared, when it is last appeared, so thereby you can find out the total range. This is known as biozone. And similarly, by identifying one particular different fossil forms, and when what is the first appearance, what is the last appearance, and what is the first appearance of another organism, what is the last appearance of the organism, and when these two forms are concurring in their age distribution, thereby you can get the concurrent range zone. Like that, you know, they are helpful. Biozones can be established. And now, as far as major mass extinctions, I told you already, mass extinctions have taken place 5 times in the history of the Earth. Ordovician to Silurian time and Devonian to Carboniferous time. These two major mass extinctions have taken place in the Paleozoic era. So this is the time period which has taken place, and this is the percentage of the life that got disappeared. And the cause, major cause, is volcanism. Even though the KTB Deccan volcanism, that is bolide impact, is also there, another concept is also there, but if you see the extinction, major cause is throughout all the extinctions have taken place because of the volcanic activity only, mostly. And then Permian Triassic extinction, 250 million years to 260 million years time period, 85% of the life is disappeared during that time. And the Siberian flood blizzard is the major cause. And then Triassic Jurassic time, and 40%, the Karoo volcanism, Central Atlantic volcanism. These are the main causes. And then KT boundary, Cretaceous Tertiary volcanism, the major culprit is Deccan volcanic activity, and then asteroid and bolide impact is there also. Of course, for both these, we have the evidences for both these concepts, for the extinction of the Cretaceous Tertiary time volcanism, that is 65 million years ago it has taken place, 65 to 70% of the life is disappeared. Then why we call it as a KTB? Why not? It is Cretaceous Tertiary, means CT, it should be CTB, Cretaceous Tertiary. But during the within the Cretaceous, there is a time period known as Cenomonian Turonian. During this Cenomonian Turonian time, about 93.9 million years ago, there was a minor mass extinction has taken place within the Cretaceous period. So in order to avoid that duplication of the name, they have taken KTB as on. K stands for Crede. It's a German term, which means Cretaceous, 145 to 65 million years ago, it has taken place. And T stands for Tertiary, B is boundary, Cretaceous Tertiary boundary, at a place called, at a time period is known as 65 to 65.5 megaannum. Then what are the evidences for this impact? One is iridium anomaly. Iridium is considered as extraterrestrial element. So iridium occurrence is seen at the Cretaceous Tertiary boundary, and you get the shocked quartz, and for which location Chicxulub in Mexico, that is the impact crater, is found. It is also even now you can see that Chicxulub place. Then isotope ratios, osmium isotope is more at the at the site impact evidences. These are all some of the important evidences for the impact. And where do you get the shocked quartz? And the shocked quartz can be recorded at the high impact craters and at the nuclear test sites, and the material subjected to extreme shock in the laboratory and also in the KT boundary clay layers. So these are, so when you create a more high power energy, and these quartz, they become shocked quartz. So this is a pictorial one, Chicxulub impact. And the impact scenario, see, a 10 kilometer diameter of the meteorite or asteroid, when it hit the earth at a speed of 10 kilometer per second, the heat generated is more than 10,000 times total world nuclear arsenal. So that much of energy, that much of heat is heat generates. That is the reason why during that time major dominant organisms, dinosaurs, disappeared, and at the same time in the ammonites, the marine environment forms, they disappeared. And impact consequences, it creates 150 to 175 kilometer wide crater, and it kills everything within the site of the fireball. So why? Because that much heat is there, you know, and it causes dust clouds for months and years. When the dust cloud is formed, sunlight penetration will not take place, and when the sunlight doesn't come into the earth, the vegetation growth hampers, thereby the herbivorous dinosaurs, the food was not available for them and they died out. So food chain collapse, and the impact winter, then fire, then because of that, and then acid rains because of that, you know. So the temperature is increased. Then extinction of marine fauna, the shock heating of atmosphere, rise in temperatures, oxygen and nitrogen combined to form nitrous oxide, which led to the formation of the acidic water. So acidification of the marine environment takes place, thereby the calcareous shells, they got dissolved, and thereby the calcareous organism, the shells, the organisms which are having the calcareous shells, they could not survive. Of course, there are other organisms survived, maybe due to their susceptibility, maybe due to their comeback. I mean, they are able to sustain themselves. The other organisms like the ammonites, they could not sustain, they died out. And then that is with regard to the extinction measures. And continental drift also, the fossils will be helpful in knowing the continental drift or seafloor spreading. So during the Permian time, this is the configuration, and Triassic time, you have the Laurasia and Gondwana land, and the Jurassic time, as I told you, you have got the appearance of the Indian Ocean and Atlantic Ocean, and during the Cretaceous time, this is the configuration, this is the present day configuration. So it was united in the geological past, and later on it got departed. If you see the fossil content of the east, west coast of Africa and the east coast of South America, the similar fossil content of vegetative fossil plants, and also the fossils of horses and the fossils of other kinds of, they are similar assemblages found, but now they are very wide apart. The water mass is there in between, Atlantic Ocean is there, and it gives you an impression, it gives you a conclusion that these two land masses were united in the geological past. Now only they got departed, they got separated. Otherwise, you know, this plant fossil remains, which are similar assemblages along the west coast of Africa and the east coast of South America, would not have taken place. Why? Because they cannot move on their own. So like that, you know, so you have got the implications, the applications in the continental drift and seafloor spreading also. So as far as our Indian subcontinent is concerned, now it was joined with the Gondwana land, and later on it got departed, it got separated from the Gondwana land, and slowly moved northeasterly direction, and it collided with the Eurasian plate. And when it was in the Gondwana land, it was in the southern hemisphere. Now India is in northern hemisphere. It moved nearly, it traveled nearly 6,000 kilometers plus journey, and that journey has taken place about 40 to 50 million years. So from this, it is deduced that, it is inferred that the Indian subcontinent, of course, all these plates are dynamic, they are in continuous motion, they are continuously traveling. Even our Indian subcontinent is also in motion. It travels at a speed of 4.5 centimeter per annum. It is still moving in this direction. Then come to microfossils. That is with regard to the mega fossils, their distribution, their occurrence, their applications, etc. And now let us come to the next part of my talk. That is microfossils. Microfossils are nothing but, as I told you, the fossils which are very tiny in size, whose morphological characters can be best studied under a stereo binocular microscope, that is known as a microfossil. And there are various groups of microfossils based upon the chemical composition with which that particular microfossil shell or external material is made up of. They are being classified into two categories broadly. One is mineral world, other one is organic world. Within the mineral world, you have the calcareous, you have the siliceous, you have the phosphatic forms. Calcareous forms, microfossils are nothing but, they are made up of calcium carbonate. Examples, foraminifera, ostracoda, nanoplankton, theropods, calcareous algae, bryozoa. And siliceous forms, their external shell is made up of silica with some amount of water, that is radially rayon diatom, silicoflagellates. Phosphatic forms, here these microorganisms or microfossils are made up of apatritic composition. Examples are conodonts. And organic world, here it is completely made up of carbon and hydrogen only. Examples, spores, pollen grains, secretas, chitinozoans, etc. So this is the SEM photograph, some of the calcareous forms. You have the foraminifers, you have the ostracods, you have the ostracoda, and you have the arenaceous textularia foraminifera. And in the siliceous forms, of course, I'm sorry, this move. Siliceous forms, you have the radial area, rounded, spherical, symmetrical forms, and they are the spumellarians. Helmet-shaped or cap-shaped forms, they are the nacellarians. Under the siliceous forms, you also have the diatoms. And diatoms are two types. One is rounded centric forms, and the elongate pinnate forms. So these are all the coccoliths. They are the calcareous in nature, and they come under calcareous group. And then phosphatic, you have the conodonts, as I already told you. Conodonts, plate type and platform type. And organic world group of microfossils, you have the spores and pollen grains. And this is a benthic foraminifera. You can see the cluster. So this name of the genus is Bolivina, a cluster of benthic foraminifera. Benthic forms are generally forms which dwell at the sediments, the bottom of the sea or bottom of the river or bottom of the lake, etc. And Arbolina universa, it's a planktonic foraminifera. See how beautifully this is a life form. Arbolina universa is a unilocular form. See the flagella and other thing, planktonic foraminifera. And then come to the palynology. And the plant kingdom is divided into two categories, non-flowering and flowering. And non-flowering, you have the algae, fungi, bryophyta, pteridophyta, gymnosperms. Under the flowering, you have the angiosperms. Angiosperms appeared in the Jurassic time. Then palynology, as far as micro types of palyno groups are concerned, you have the spores and pollen grains, dinoflagellates, accretes, and diatoms, silicoflagellates, calcareous algae. All these are the plant-related micro groups, and their size is generally less than 200 microns. So spores are the reproductive bodies of non-flowering plants, and pollen are the male reproductive bodies of flowering plants, both gymnosperms. The main advantage of these spores and pollen grains are the organic, these dinoflagellates and other thing is, they have an external wall structure, the wall, which is highly resistant. Even they can withstand to the acidic water because it is composed of a resin known as sporopolynin. sporopollenin is an organic constituent. It is made up of externally. That is the reason why, and they are highly resistant and they are very much preserved in any kind of environment. Even the acidic water is present in that. So that is the reason why sometimes, you know, when you study the paleo tsunami and paleo storm surges, and because of the acidic water, other things, the foraminifers and arthropods, they get dissolved, they get decomposed. But you can search for these spores and pollen grains and diatoms and other things, we can find out these forms. And this is the figure tells you the geological range in time of all these microfossils. Say for example, in calcareous category, you have the algae, you have the arthropoda, foraminifera and bryozoa. They are found to occur in the entire Phanerozoic eon, starting from Cambrian to recent. Whereas theropods, they appeared in the late in the Cretaceous time. Cretaceous to recent is the theropods. And then when you come to the phosphatic conodonts, they appeared in the Cambrian time and disappeared in the late Triassic. So from Jurassic onwards, you don't see any conodonts. So like that, and these conodonts, they are very much helpful in the biostratigraphic applications of particularly the Paleozoic era. Similarly, when you come to the Silozoic, siliceous forms, you have the diatoms, you have the silicoflagellate. Diatoms appeared in the early Cretaceous onwards, early Cretaceous to recent. That is the geological range and time of the entire diatoms, diatoms and silicoflagellates, etc. So this particular figure shows you the respective geological range and time of individual group of organisms. And as far as the historical review of micropaleontology, it was originally studied by Strabo, Herodotus, Pliny, Leonardo da Vinci, etc. And these are the people who studied Linnaeus also. And they studied the coin-shaped forms, pneumolites, and which are present in the limestones which are used in the building of Egyptian pyramids. And they have observed the coin-shaped pneumolites in the Shelly limestones. So if you date back the historical study of micropaleontology, you can date back to 7th century, 5th century. It was a very primitive stage at that time. And then after that, in the 19th century, it has grown to a concrete science because of the monumental work of Alice D. Arbigny, C.G. Ehrenberg, Olli, and other people. Alice D. Arbigny, he carried out a detailed descriptive work of foraminifera, which has led to the first classification of foraminifera in the year 1836. C.G. Ehrenberg, he is considered as the father of modern micropaleontology. He discovered and described silicoflagellates, coccoles, dinoflagellates, foraminifera, radiolaria. Extensive study he has made. And after that, the deep sea drilling projects, geoids in 1965, deep sea drilling in 1968, and the ocean drilling projects, it has led to the important phase of the history of the growth of micropaleontology. This particular programs has led to the identification of opening and closing of the seaways. When these Atlantic Ocean, Indian Ocean, other kinds of seas, and they got opened up, and other paleo seas, they got closed up. So this particular sea program, deep sea drilling programs are helpful in that. And then without, as I told you, and microfossils, they are very small in size. For example, foraminifera and arthropoda in millimeter size, 1 millimeter, 0.5 millimeter. But these other palynomorphs are in micron size. And without the microscope, they cannot be studied. So for which the microscope is being discovered or identified in the year 1660 by Otton Leeuwenhoek. So that this is considered as the milestone. With the help of the microscope only, we can do the micropaleontological research work. And similarly, all these megafossil and microfossil, they are being denoted by two names. One is the generic name, other one is the species name. So the systematic classification, Linnaeus binomial nomenclature, has helped in identifying the species into genera and species, etc. Otherwise, what will happen? People working at European region, American region, Asiatic region, and without knowingly, they create new names, new species names will be there, overlapping, ambiguity, confusion will be there. So once you follow this binomial nomenclature, and that ambiguity, confusion and error can be avoided. So in order to know our naming of species is known as etymology. Naming of any species is known as etymology. And in order to name the animals, there is a code of international code of zoological nomenclature, ICZN. And in order to name the botany, that is plant form, there is an international code of botanical nomenclature is there. So this ICZN, ICBN codes have to be followed in order to avoid the repetition of the names, overlapping of the names, and the ambiguity or any confusion that helps. Then as far as microfossils, the significance, because they are very minute in size. Even the small quantity of the sample, 100 gram of sample, gives you good number of species, good number of fossils. And if you take 10 grams of or 5 grams of sediment, and if you see the diatoms or dinoflagellates and other kinds of these paleonomorphs, you get plenty. You get hundreds and thousands. So that is the advantage. Whereas megafossils, you know, you have to survey, you have to do a lot of area, and you will come across one or two fossils only. So, but microfossils, they have got that advantage. Even the small quantity of the sample will yield you good number of microfossils. And another important point is they have rapid evolutionary change, and they are very sensitive to the environmental change. Thereby, the paleo-environmental implications, interpretations can be easily made because of their rapid evolution and sensitive to the environmental change. And also ready-made catalogs are also available. So small size, ubiquitous distribution, worldwide distribution, and also the rapid evolution, and also the sensitive to the environmental condition. So as I told you, this is a stereo binocular microscope. With the help of that, foraminifera, radiolaria, and osteopoda, they can be identified. Modern polarized light microscope is useful in order to study the diatoms and silicoflagellates, spores and pollen grains, and coccoliths, like that, tiny micron-sized organisms. And scanning electron microscope is very much needed these days, because, and even then, you follow all these codes and you see the microscope, different microscopes, and still some confusion, some errors will happen. But if you take a photograph from the scanning electron microscope, there won't be any error. Why? Because you can enlarge the microfossil photograph to a required size, and 5,000 times, 10,000 times, 20,000 times, you can magnify, and thereby you can take the photograph. Even the ultra structure of the microfossils you can take, and thereby the ambiguity and confusion can be avoided, and the errors can be avoided. So after the invention of the scanning electron microscope, the taxonomical studies is enhanced. So with regard to the fossils, for example, on which group of organisms, fossil microorganisms you are working. Say for example, if you are working on osteopods, then you have to search for the what kind of sediment we have to search. Blindly, you cannot go and search in all kinds of sediments. It depends upon the type of the organism, the type of the microfossil on which you are doing the research work. Accordingly, you have to select the type of the sediment, and thereby you can get the microfossil. Say for example, if it is an osteopods, you have to search for the limestones preferably, and then marls and clays and sandstones. And you should not see for coal and then the other kinds of flint and chets, siliceous. So you will not get that. So for which you have to see. Suppose if you are working on foraminifera, then you have to see for this limestones, sandstone. So in limestones, you will get abundantly. So the large circle indicates their abundant occurrence. Small circle indicates the rare occurrence. And the circle, you know, undotted circle tells you that it is a sporadic occurrence. Say for example, when you are working on radiolaria, you should not see for coal and lignites, you should not see for sandstones. You have to see for the, why? Because these are all the siliceous forms. And you have to see for the jaspites, flint, chets, etc. And limestones, rarely you will get. So like that, you know, this particular table tells you what kind of the fossil forms and where they are occurring in the sediments abundantly, rarely, and sporadically. Then come to my group of my interesting group of astronauts, on which I have got nearly about two and a half decades of experience, expertise on this. So astropods, even though they are microfossils and they belong to the phylum Arthropoda because of its internal morphological characteristics. So they belong to phylum Arthropods. Arthropods are found to occur from Cambrian onwards. So similarly, astropods also, if you see the geological range in time, Cambrian more or less Ordovician to recent. So that means in the entire Phanerozoic eon, astropods are found to occur. They first appeared in Cambrian only, but the Cambrian authentic reports are rare. But from Ordovician onwards, they are being well reported, well established reports are there, Ordovician to recent. And the external shell of Ostracoda is known as carapace, which is made up of calcium carbonate. And that is why they are considered under calcareous group of microfossils, carapace. This carapace has got the size from 0.5 to 1 millimeter. And as far as their habit is concerned, most of the ostracods are benthic in nature. Benthic in nature means some are sessile and some are vagrant. Vagrant means the movable forms. And some of the forms are infaunal. And some ostracods, they drill the sediments, they hole, and they live inside. And those forms are called infaunal. And some are epifaunal. Some of the forms, they live in the superficial sediments. They are called epifaunals. And of course, you do have the pelagic forms, that is nectons. Nectons means, because the if you see the internal soft parts, and these ostracods will have the seven pairs of appendages. And these appendages perform different functions. Among these, one of the appendages, they are helpful in swimming in the water column, swimming the organism in the water column. With the help of that, they are able to swim. They are the nectons. As I told you in the beginning itself, planktons are there, nectons are there. Planktons are the one which don't have any kind of locomotory organ, devoid of locomotory organs, and they are called as planktons. And their movement depends upon the underwater current, the winds, tides, etc. But whereas nectons, they are able to move on their own with the help of the pseudopodia, with the help of the flagella, with the help of the cilia, or with the help of the appendages, or with the help of the fins, or whatever it may be, some kind of locomotory organ will be there. And with the help of that, they keep moving. They are called as nectons. And now, the ostracods, they have the habit, diversified habitat is there. Habitat. Habitat is a natural home of organisms. They are the most aquatic forms. They are found to occur in freshwater, lakes, rivers, ponds, pools, etc. And the brackish water environment also they live, like your estuaries, backwaters, mangrove environment, and then lagoons, etc. And also they are found to occur in the marine environment, starting from shallow marine to deep marine environment. So that is the diversification in the habitat of ostracoda is concerned. This is the brief introduction about ostracods. So this picture, this figure tells you that, so this is a lagoon type, and this is a pond type, pond. Freshwater forms will be there, a pond or a small lake, freshwater cypress, and this is a river. The river joins the sea, estuary is there. So in the estuarine region also, you get the certain estuarine forms will be there. And this is a lagoon, upper Salan lagoon will be there. And you also have the shallow marine forms, you also have the deep marine forms. Shallow marine, meritic assemblage to the bathyal assemblage and abyssal assemblage. And not only that, ostracods are found to occur in the forest humid soils, like your mesocypress. Mesocypress occurs in the forest humid soils. Not only that, in the rice fields also, in the rice fields soils also, they are recorded. And in the intestines of fishes also, these ostracods are recorded. So they are diversified. And then, as far as the stratigraphic position, stratigraphic range of these ostracods, you have the archaeocopids, lepidopterygopids, like that podocopids, myodocopids, platycopids, like that different groups are there. Among these groups, archaeocopids and lepidopterygopids are the Paleozoic forms, and also these bericopids also. And archaeocopids, lepidocopids, they are occurring abundantly in the Cambrian time. And these lepidopterygopids started appearing from the Ordovician and disappeared during the Devonian. whereas Copida means order, Copina means suborder, like that. Okay, so Bericopina, they appear at the bottom of the at the beginning of the Ordovician, and they are dominant, abundant. Later on, they slowly decline their population. At the end of the Permian, they disappeared. Whereas Podocopids are the present day highly abundant organic forms of arthropods. Podocopids, they appear in the Ordovician time only, but they are very rarely distributed in different geological time period. But from Jurassic onwards, they are widespread, abundantly occurring. Now in the Quaternary time, the present times, even now they are living. Living forms are of Podocopids are there. They are widespread, highly abundant, widely distributed. And I told you, Myrdocopids are the planktons, planktonic forms. They appeared in the Ordovician time. And during this Paleozoic time, late Paleozoic, they are distributed, they are abundant, they are moderately distributed, and they are very rarely distributed in the later part of the geological time scale. And now in the Quaternary period, they are to some extent, they are present. So this is how the stratigraphic position of different groups of arthropods. Then, as far as arthropods are concerned, they don't grow continuously. The size of the animal will not grow continuously. At a periodic stage, it sheds out the external shell and create a new shell. That is known as ecdysis, and that is also known as molting. There are 8 growth stages of arthropods, and 9th one will be the adult stage. That is known as ontogeny. 9th one will be the adult stage. Generally, in a pristine environment, in an unpolluted environment, you are supposed to get, if it is having good amount of nutrient and pristine and unpolluted environment, you are supposed to get all the 8 growth stages, and 9th one will be the adult form. The initial growth stages, we call them as juveniles. So 8 juveniles will be there, 9th one will be the adult. So by identifying the juveniles and the adults ratio, we can find out the environment. We can find out the environment, if whether it is a polluted environment or a disturbed environment or like that. And also, as far as the sexual dimorphism is concerned, here you have sexual dimorphism. You have the male forms and female forms. Males are more elongated and less height. So this is the length from one end to the other, that is anterior to posterior, this is the length. And from dorsal to ventral, this is known as height. And in case of males, there won't be other morphological difference. Only thing is the size. The same morphology will be there, but the size is, in case of males, they are more length and less height. In case of females, the more height and less length. That is the only difference. And in addition to that, one more difference is, in female forms, there will be a brood cavity in the posterior side. Brood cavity is nothing but a small cavity in which the female form lay the eggs, and these eggs are hatched, and thereby the population comes. So that is, that process is known as parthenogenesis. Just like your hen, it rests over the eggs, and it hatches and offsprings comes, like that. Similarly, the female ostracoda, it lays the eggs, and after some time, the hatching takes place, and thereby the offsprings are developed without the involvement of the male forms. The involvement of the male forms also takes place, thereby generation is there, sexual this thing. Otherwise also asexual process of generation, and females, they hatch the eggs and the offsprings are developed. That process is known as parthenogenesis. Then come to the important aspects. That is, any group of organism for that matter, so it is being controlled by, the ecological aspects are being controlled by 3 parameters: physical, chemical, and biological parameters. Physical parameters and chemical parameters and biological parameters play a vital role on the abundance, distribution, and diversity of a group of organisms. For example, we will see one after another. Temperature is considered as one of the important physical parameter of arthropoda in the controlling of the ecology of arthropods. And these arthropods, they occur in a tropical and temperate environment, and also in the cold environments. So cold deep water forms, they are called as cycloceric, and warm shallow water forms, they are called thermophoric. If you see the earth, at the equator, the warm water will be there. warm water will be there. That is the tropical environment. Away from the equator, if you go beyond the 20 degree north or 20 degree south, then temperate water, less temperate. And if you go very close to the poles, North Pole and South Pole, you have the cold water. So like that, the ecology, as far as the temperature parameter is concerned, you do have the cold water forms, warm water forms and temperate forms. So, and also, as far as the depth also concerned, shallow marine forms are also there, deep marine forms are also there. There is one genus, Heterocypris. It has got a capacity of withstanding the temperature at 50 degrees centigrade. And by studying the isotopics of stable isotope of oxygen-18 and the C-13 of gastropods, you will get the paleosalinity, paleotemperature of the environment. Then the next parameter is salinity. Temperature is that one. And salinity also is one of the important controlling parameter on the distribution and diversity of gastropoda. Wagner, in the year 1957, he has classified the gastropods based upon the salinity content. Salinity content is nothing but the salt content in the water. If you see the limnitic and freshwater environment, here the salinity range will be 0.2 to 0.5 parts per thousand. And in the estuarine environment, the salinity ranges from 2 to 10 parts per thousand. So the fresh to oligoalkaline species, oligoalkaline to mesoalkaline, A, B category. So like that. And when you come to the high saline content, more than 32 parts per thousand, it comes a marine environment. Oligoalkaline, mesoalkaline, estuarine environment. Limnitic at freshwater is the riverine environment. Freshwater, rivers, lakes, ponds, pools, etc. So accordingly, the salinity wise also you can classify the gastropods. So this is the internal view of, as I told you, when the animal is present, it is having two shells, and these two shells are attached. Within that, the soft parts are enclosed, and these two shells, two valves together, when they are attached, is called as carapace. When it got detached, we call it as open valve. When it got detached, it is called as open valve. So in the internally, these are all the morphological characters. You can see the muscle scars, you can see the hinge, you can see the inner lamella traversed by numerous pore canals. So these are the external views, SEM views of the gastropoda. Here you can see the ornamentation. Here you don't see any ornamentation, smooth forms. So ornamentation also plays a role in the identification of the environment in which it is lived. And then hinge plays a major role. Just by studying hinge, without identification, just by identifying the hinge itself, we can find out whether the fossils, they lived, the organism lived in the freshwater, marine water, or brackish water. So for example, if you see an adult hinge, it means the organism lived in a freshwater or deep marine water. And myrodont hinge, it is present in the brackish water forms. Amphidont hinge is seen in the gastropods which lived in the shallow marine environment. Shallow marine environment, there will be a turbulence. In order to withstand, in order to form fixation of the gastropod carapace, it has to build a strong hinge type. That is known as amphidont hinge. Then come to salinity and depth. The freshwater forms, they will have smooth, thin carapace, adult hinge, absence of caudal process, all these eye spots, all these things are the freshwater characteristics and freshwater species like Limnocichthyes, Candida. Brackish water forms, they are called the mesohaline forms, and weak ornamentation hinges myrodont. And sometimes, you know, as they move from brackish water to marine, the slowly myrodont to amphidont hinge type, it develops. And then the marine form, shallow marine, they are the thick shells. Why? Because in order to, they take the calcium carbonate from the water and build a strong, robust shell and strong amphidont hinge, branched pore canals, well-developed eye spots, strong ornamentation, and they occur in coarse grain sediments. So examples are Trachylepis, Quadracete. Again, deep water forms, they are the smooth and thin carapace, weak hinge, and no eyes. Why? Because they dwell at a deeper water, and sunlight will not be available, they become blind. And cyclospheric forms, depth more than 1000 meters, and the temperature is 4 to 6 degrees centigrade. Agrinocyderis and Posidon amicus. So the depth as well as temperature, they also play. Accordingly, the assemblage varies, the assemblage changes. And this already I'll explain to you. Psychrospheric means deep water and cold water forms. Thermospheric means shallow water and their characters. Then substrate also, there are sandy substrate, silty substrate, clayey substrate, and some of the forms are infaunal, some of the forms are epifaunal, and infaunal forms are the burrowers. Infaunal means they keep burrowing the sediment, you know, and when they burrow in the silt and clayey substrate, they are called as endophilos. And if they burrow in sandy substrate, that is in coarse grain, this is in fine grain burrowers are endophilos. Coarse grain, medium to coarse grain burrowers are endosalmon. And similarly, wanderers are crawlers, which are living on the top layers of the sediments. They are called the epifaunal forms. And wanderers, fine-grained wanderers are epiphilos, and medium to coarse-grained wanderers are episalmon. So like that, we classify them based upon their morphology. So as I told you already, the substrate and as well as salinity and temperature, these are the three main parameters which control the distribution and the ecological aspects of Osteopoda. And that is with regard to the physical as well as chemical parameter. Now come to the biological parameter. Among the biological parameter, food supply and the predation, these are the two important. As far as osteopods are concerned, they feed on algae, they feed on diatoms, etc. And wherever you have got abundant algal amount is there, and the osteopod population will be more. And similarly, predation is another important biological parameter. Predation is nothing but the higher organisms, say for example gastropods, barnacles, they come and just make a drill hole and eat away the soft parts of osteopods. So that process is known as predation. The higher organism comes, attacks the lower organism, eats away the soft parts, and without disturbing, without damaging the entire shell, just they make a hole and they feed on that. So as far as in case of osteopods, two organisms they predate. One is gastropods, other one is barnacles. And gastropod predation is of two types. One is muricid predation, naticid predation. Muricid predation is here, these gastropods, they come and make a hole in the deep marine environment. Deep marine gastropods, they make a hole in the oblique direction, and also the hole will be irregular in size. Whereas naticid predation is the osteopods which are living in the shallow marine, and the gastropods which are living in the shallow marine, they come and attack the osteopods, and they make a vertical hole, not an oblique hole. Oblique hole is muricid, deep marine environment. Naticid means the shallow osteopods are being predated by the shallow gastropods, and the hole will be vertical hole, and the hole will be circular or semicircular. Whereas muricid, irregular holes. That way, you just remember that. You just remember that point. Naticid predation is vertical hole, circular, and shallow marine. That is with regard to the ecological aspects of osteopods. Let us see how these osteopods are helpful in knowing the paleo environment, and thereby to deduce the petroleum presence in the sediments. Certain statistical parameters of osteopods are very much helpful in order to find out the paleo-environmental aspects of sediments, like your carapace-valve ratio, degree of pyritization, current index. All these are some of the parameters. Let us see one after another. And among which, color pattern is very important. Why? Because generally osteopods, they occur in a pristine environment, in a unpolluted environment, in a fragile environment, in a environment. They occur in light colors, light yellow, colorless, light colored forms. It indicates that they are oxygenated. It was an oxygenated environment. Whereas sometimes, you know, you get the fossils of osteopods in black color, dark green, gray colored, and sometimes reddish color also. And it indicates that the environment, it got oxygenated to reduced. Reduced environment, anoxic environment, it becomes anoxic environment. Generally, anoxic environment is more favorable for the it is required for the generation of the hydrocarbons. Why? Because whatever the organic matter that is present in the sediments, it converts into kerosene, and thereby it converts into gas or oil. It gas or oil depending upon the temperature and pressure conditions. So what is needed? What are the organic matter? It has to be preserved and it converts into kerosene. So the preservation of the organic matter takes place only in the reduced environment, in an anoxic environment. If it is an oxic environment, what happens? The whatever the organic matter that is present, it gets decomposed, it gets disintegrated. So in order to preserve this organic matter, you need to have a reduced environment or an anoxic environment. The anoxic environment can be identified by the presence of black colored or dark green, gray colored arthropod fossils. Then carapace and valve ratio. Once in a basin, when you have the sedimentation, when you have the environment, when you have the organisms, particularly the arthropods, as the arthropods, if they die, once the arthropods die out, they go and settle down in the sediments. They get deposited in the sediments. In the sediments, if there is a continuous deposition of the sediments, the dead organism, the dead arthropoda, will be preserved as such. The more closed carapaces will be preserved as such. Suppose if there is no continuous deposition of the sediments, continuous sedimentation is not there, the dead organism, it will be acted by the bacteria, or because of the current underwater currents, there is a chance of getting detached. Then you will get more open valves. So the ratio of carapaces and open valves will tell you an information with regard to the relative rate of sedimentation. If the high rate of sedimentation is there, the more arthropod carapace fossils will be there. If low rate of sedimentation is there, and you get more of open wall fossil arthropods will be there. So this particular ratio, this particular statistical parameter is very much helpful in knowing a faster rate of sedimentation or a slow rate of sedimentation. This particular parameter is being used by McKenzie and Guha, and from the Eocene Oligocene basins of Australia and India, and they have observed rapid rate of sedimentation. They have observed rapid rate of sedimentation means they observed in these Eocene Oligocene basins more of closed carapaces. And similarly, Ahmed and Neely observed high rate of sedimentation in the upper Eocene, lower Miocene deposits of Lindi area, Tanzania. That means high rate of sedimentation means here the arthropods are arthropod fossils which they have recorded are carapaces. Whereas in the Oligocene deposits of those areas, they have recorded rather less rate of sedimentation. It means that they have recorded more of open valves. And similarly, Guha. Guha is one of the pioneers of arthropoda research work in India. He studied Eocene sediments of Kambe Basin, where he has recorded 100% of closed carapaces, which indicates that the rapid rate of sedimentation. You need a very rapid rate of sedimentation for the generation of the hydrocarbons. Why? Because only when you have a rapid rate of sedimentation, whatever the organic matter, it comes from the microorganisms, which is being preserved in the sediments. If it is not a rapid rate of sedimentation or slow rate of sedimentation, whatever the organic matter is there, it gets decomposed. So preservation will be taken place in a rapid rate of sedimentation only. Then degree of pyritization. So the pyrite crystals generally form in a reduced or anoxic environment, anoxic environment. So these pyrite crystals adhere or agglutinate over the carapace of the arthropoda. When you have the fossil arthropods with more agglutinated pyritized crystals, it indicates that it is a brackish, it is a reduced environment. It is a anoxic environment. So you can find out what kind of environment it is, what kind of sedimentation it is in a basin, and thereby you can identify whether the sediments have the potential hydrocarbon content or not. Like that, you can find out. And current index is another important parameter. Here, current index is determined based on the percentage of adult and juveniles. I have already explained you what is a juvenile, what is adult. And in an undisturbed fauna, both adult and juvenile carapaces are expected. But if the currents are active, they disturb this ratio. They disturb in ratio. Say, for example, higher value of index is met in littoral environment. Why? Because there is a continuous motion of the underwater currents. And low current index is seen in the lagoonal assemblage. Out of these two, low current index is much favorable. Why? Because in the currents are not in motion, the sediments get deposited and the organic matter will be preserved. So lagoonal assemblage is more important for the generation of the hydrocarbons rather than the littoral environments. And other ratios like compaction ratio. When you have the ostracoda carapace is there, if more sedimentation is there, continuous high thick pile of sediments are there, and the ostracoda compaction ratio, the preservation, the compaction will be more. When you have a less thick of sediments will be there, the ostracoda carapace will not get more compaction. So like that, you know, high compacted ostracoda fossils will be helpful in knowing the continuous thick deposition of the sediments and preservation of this carapace. And then other parameters like males and females, right wall, left wall, normal. So these are all the other, some of the parameters. The efficacy of these parameters is not fully established. It is still, research work is going on. But the other parameters like color pattern, iridization, carapace valve ratio, current index, all these parameters are very much helpful in a basin to identify whether the sediments are having the potentiality to retain, to get the hydrocarbons in that or not. We can identify from that. And this is with regard to the applications of ostracoda in the ecological aspects or also in the paleo environmental in knowing the hydrocarbon potentiality of the sediments. So whatever the parameters which I have already explained to you, those statistical aspects we have taken into consideration, and a couple of case studies I just would like to explain to you before the time ends. My time given is up to 5 o'clock. Before that, I will just explain to you. One of the case studies is recent benthic ostracoda distribution from the inner shelf of Chennai to know the implication on the micro environment. So for this, we have collected 56 sediment samples from the Karikattukuppam, a small fishing hamlet near Chennai, and which yielded 51 ostracoda taxa. And these are the parameters: carapace valve ratio, predation, color pattern, ornamentation. As I told you, ornamentation in the soft, silty, fine, muddy sediment, the ostracoda carapace will have less ornamentation or smooth ornamentation. Whereas if the sediment is coarse, medium size sand or like that, there the ostracoda carapace will have moderate to high ornamentation. So ornamentation also, from the ornamentation we can find out the type of the substrate or the type of the sediment. So this is the field photograph, a single transect up to a depth of 50 meter water depth we have collected the sample. And this is the field photograph, collection of the sediment sample with the help of the crab. And these are the species which we have recorded, 51 species, doesn't matter the names. And these species which are marked, you know, they got predated. Only few got predated. And these are the table showing the ostracoda carapace valve ratio. And we have collected the samples in 4 different seasons: October northeast monsoon, January winter, April summer, July southwest monsoon. In 4 different seasons, why we collect this? In order to know the ecological parameters. They vary in different seasons. Say for example, in winter, the less temperature will be there, less salinity will be there. Whereas in case of April, high salinity will be there, high temperature will be there. In the monsoon period, during northeast and southwest monsoon, more freshwater influx will be there, more sediment is being brought. Like that, you know, ecological parameters vary from season to season. For that reason, we have collected the samples in different seasons, and all these samples are analyzed for ostracoda fauna, and also the numerical count of ostracoda carapace and valve ratio is being done. And yes, this particular table tells you the distribution of carapaces and open valves. The open carapaces are less in number when compared to the open valves. Open valves are representing more than 60% or 70%, and carapace valve is less. What it implies? It implies that here more open valves means less sedimentation rate. Less sedimentation rate. If a Karikattukuppam fishing hamlet, you don't get any kind of a freshwater sediments, continental sediments. Why? Because there's no river there. The similar kind of study we have made near Tamarbirani estuary, there we have observed carapaces more than 80%, open wells less than 20%. That means there it was a rapid rate of sedimentation because in Tamarbirani estuary, more of freshwater sediments are being derived from the Tambalpalli River. But whereas in this particular study area, Karikattukuppam, there is no major river, continental sediments are being transported and deposited. Okay, so this is the histogram telling you, showing you the open walls and carapace ratio. I'm sorry, this is the predatory shells, and they are less in number. But let us see the shape of the predation and the size, this thing. Yeah, here. So these are the CSM photographs of the ostracod species which we have recorded. They're all ornamented species. And it indicates that the sediment type there is silty sand to sand. So directly you can give. So you need not bother about the species identification. So just by seeing the type of the species, you can give the type of the sediment. And here it is a vertical hole. The hole is circular or semicircular. It indicates it is a natticid predation. Natticid predation is confined to shallow marine. Our sediments are collected up to 50 meters only. Beyond 50 meters, if you go beyond 200 meters, you will get muricid predation. Here it is a natticid predation. So whatever the study which we have done, it is coinciding. So from the carapace wall ratio, it is a slow rate of sedimentation, and the predation, and the shells which we have recorded are white and yellow colored, which indicate the sediments are in normal oxygenated environment. It is an oxidized environment, oxygenated environment condition like this. And this particular study we have published there. So then come to the another case study. I'll just go fast. So the same parameters which we have employed. This is a lagoon, Mullipalam lagoon. This is a park strait, Mullipalam lagoon. We have collected a few samples and distributaries of Kaveri. These five, they bring lot of sediment, particularly during the monsoon time, and a lot of silt content is silt and clay content is deposited here. So field work is done during the pre-monsoon and post-monsoon. This is the study area field photograph and collection of the sample through the core. And I mean through the grab, this is the Van Veen grab sample, okay. And then core sample collection. These are the cores, and cores we collect because how these ostracoda distribution is done from the bottom to top. What is the variation? Biodiversity variation. So this is the ostracoda carapace infrared ratio. Here you see ostracoda carapace this much. And open walls this much, out of the total this so many ostracod specimens. Out of this so many ostracod specimens, so many are carapaces. What it implies? More number of carapaces, more percentage of carapaces there. It implies that more sedimentation rate, faster sedimentation rate, high sedimentation rate. Five distributaries of Kaveri are debouching the sediments in the Mullipalam lagoon. The similar observation here also, this is in the post-monsoon. In the previous one, this is pre-monsoon. Not only in the pre-monsoon, but also in the post-monsoon, you find that we have recorded more carapaces. It implies that the sedimentation rate is faster, high. And these are all the ostracod species. And these are all the predation. See, what kind of predation is? Natticid predation. Vertical hole and circular to semicircular holes. So it is a, estuary is a small, shallow, very shallow. So one thing here we observed is one or two species are dominant in this area. Particularly Pneumonocetina iniqua is recorded more than 90%, followed by Hemicythridae pekii. So one or two species dominance in a particular estuary indicates that the estuary or a lagoon is under biological stress. Biological stress in the form of intertidal settings. During the high tide time, a lot of marine water is coming. During the low tide time, the fresh water goes into the sea. And not only that, during the monsoon time, lot of fresh water influx will be there, lot of sediment is. And also adjoining area, salt pan construction is there. So because of these kind of natural activities like high tidal fluctuation and the fresh water influx during the monsoon time and the anthropogenic activity because of the agriculture and increase of the salt pans, because of these multiple parameters, the lagoon is under a biological stress. Under a biological stress environment, one or two species will be dominant over the other species. Other species will not, they cannot sustain, they cannot survive. So one or two species here, Numerus retina iniqua is a dominant species. So this type of inferences can be very much helpful. Thereby, no, you can extrapolate whatever the ecological parameters or whatever this kind of inferences you obtain from these living forms, the recent forms, you can extrapolate to the fossil forms. Thereby, you can discuss about the paleo environment or paleo other parameters. Okay, only thing is you have to establish a database for the with the help of the recent forms, and the extrapolation to the fossil forms and extrapolation to the older sediments can be done. Okay, so this also we have published. And the pollution, as I told you, it can be done with the help of the fossils. You have to collect a core sample and analyze how the biodiversity changes starting from bottom to the top, and you have to find out the age of the sediments with the help of the lead 210 dating, and you have to analyze the geochemical aspects of the shells, and thereby you can find out the industrial pollution, and this is a domestic pollution, and this is oil slick. Sometimes an oil slick takes place, and this oil layer, you know, the aquatic life danger, it is a danger to the aquatic life. And sometimes, you know, particularly foraminiferal deformities, it is well established with regard to the pollution, and it shows various morphological changes, like these type of morphological changes it shows. Okay, and finally, I'll come to the another important aspect of significance of astropoda, particularly in order to find out the high energy events. But high energy events is nothing but tsunami, like that, like that events. And tsunami, how it occurs when a plate subducts, there, you know, there is a rupture, and because of that rupture, the overlying water dislocates, and once it dislocates, it start moving. It start moving. That movement of water, that is known as tsunami. As it moves very close to the coast, you know, that is why it is called as harbor wave. Japanese term tsunami, harbor wave. So in the open ocean, the tsunami, when the water dislocates or moves, and it moves at a very faster rate, at a speed of about 700 to 800 kilometers per hour, at a speed of aeroplane. And when it is in the open ocean, and it will have a wavelength more, wave height less. As it travels, as it progresses towards the coast, the wavelength drastically reduces and wave height increases. Wave height increases. See here. So initially in the open ocean, this is the wavelength. As it progresses, as it proceeds towards the coast, wavelength drastically reduces, wave height increases. See here, 7,000 meters of water depth, velocity is 9,943 kilometers per hour, wavelength is this much. When it progresses at 50 meters of water depth, and the velocity reduces, and the wavelength also reduces. So it reduces. As it touches the coast, afterwards there is no medium to travel. So whatever the energy it accumulates, it debouches on the coastal hamlets, coastal sediments. In the process, what happens is this marine tsunami wave, it scoops the bottom sediments and takes the sediments and deposits on the coastal inlands. Coastal inlands. Those deposited sediments are known as tsunami sediments. And in the recent past also it has taken place. In the geological past also the tsunami has taken place. December 26, 1994, the tsunami has taken place. And after that we have carried out a detailed field work in the Andaman Island. So these are the photographs. These are the photographs. And in order to find out what is the extent to which these tsunami sediments are being brought on the coast, and what is the thickness they are being deposited, for that purpose we have undertaken a small project, PST project, and we have carried out a field work starting in the entire Andamans, starting from Little Andaman and Southern Andaman to North Andaman, Diglipur, Mayabandar, up to Port Blair. All these places we have collected the samples, and in the month of June 2005, and the surface samples and core samples also collected. We have worked together, and Professor Krishnamurthy is Applied Geology HOD, and myself, and we have collected the core samples. This is a small PVC core sample which we have collected away from the coast, 700 meter, 500 meter, 1 kilometer. And these cores we have collected in the mangrove area, Andaman, middle Andaman, and another collection of core sample in the middle Andaman Vartang. And here, in a place called Ramapuram, Mayabandar, this is the newly constructed building. The one which you are seeing is the first floor. The ground floor is totally got submerged because of the intensity of the earthquake. And this is the bridge, Kalighat Creek bridge, which connects Mayabandar and Diglipur. And because of the dislocation, vertical dislocation, horizontal dislocation, because of that, the transportation is stopped and people walk. So, and this is extensive damage to the mangroves. And because of this high intensity earthquake, sometimes, you know, not only the land subsidence, land upliftment has also taken place. Because of the land upliftment, when we were traveling over the boat, we were able to see the corals because of the tectonic upliftment. So extensive damage to the vegetation in South Andaman. And because of this subsidence, the seawater entered into the residential areas and people are forced to vacate. And when we inquired with the local people, the run-up is up to 7 meters. That much is the sea wave, the Mary tsunami wave has taken. Run-up and inundation. Inundation means on the land to which extent it is traveled. So in the mud volcano, in the Baratang area, it got erupted and mud start oozing. So these are all some of the field photographs. Another field photograph here, it is a vegetation. Because of the subsidence, the saline water entered into this and all freshwater plants, they died out. So results, whatever the cores, whatever the surface samples which we have collected away from the coast, and these are yielding shallow marine species, osteopods. And they are supposed to, they should not have, why? Because we have collected on the land, this the core samples we have collected, on the land. So you are not supposed to get the marine species, but we are getting the marine species in those samples. It indicates that the tsunami has brought the sediments and deposited there up to a depth of at some places, you know, it has the tsunami sediments have traveled, deposited up to 500 meters up to 700 meters, like that, depending upon the topography of the coast. If it is highly elevated, means up to 500 meters only. If it is a flat terrain, then it has gone up to 700 meters or nearly 1 kilometer at some places. All these species are shallow marine species. They confine to 40-50 meters of water depth. So from the 50 meters of water depth, the sea wave, the tsunami wave is removed the sediments and deposited on the land. So this work also we have published in the So these are all the osteopod species which we have recorded. Similar study we have carried out along the coast of Tamil Nadu also. There is a place called Velangani. What here we have done is, instead of collecting a core sample, we have opened a trench. We have opened a trench and we have collected the samples at regular intervals. But all these samples, they have not yielded microfossils, particularly foraminifera and osteopoda. And the top layer, 37 to 63 centimeter, is giving the microfossils. And the bottom layer, black sand layer, also giving the microfossils. Rest of the layers, this is a litholog of that particular trench. And they are not giving. So it indicates that this one, we infer that it is a December 26 recent tsunami and 1994 tsunami. And this one is maybe a paleo tsunami at a depth of 111 to 130 centimeter, paleo tsunami. But these osteopods, you know, we have given for the dating. Till date, we have not got the dating. Otherwise, we would have given the age of this particular paleo tsunami deposit. And the species which are recorded in Pneumonocetina iniqua, these are the species generally they are found to occur in the shallow marine environment. So this particular, sometimes, you know, we can collect the sediment sample through OSL dating can be done. And that dating results we have not obtained. That's why we are not able to do. This is a 2004 tsunami. And this bottom depth is maybe a paleo tsunami, and the age we cannot give. These are all the osteopod. These are all the osteopod species which we have recorded: Pneumonocetina iniqua, Carditis, and Tanella gracilis. And finally, my penultimate last slide, last but one slide. So, in the early days of the human appearance, we were in Stone Age, and later on, due to the intellectual power and then communication skills and good humanity and other thing, we were in Gold Age. And after that, you know, by the invent of the artificial satellites, you know, we sent the satellites into the space. We were in Stone Age, I mean Space Age. And then finally, as an education person, as a paleontologist, as a microenvironmentalist, if we don't take care of our environment, then we will be thrown into the garbage. So from the Stone Age to the Golden Age to the Space Age, and finally we end into the garbage. So finally, I thank you one and all for the opportunity given. And any questions, you can ask me.
Thank you, Professor M.S. Hussain, for such an informative session. Sir, we already have questions from the audience. Can I ask?
Yes, yes.
First question is from Priyanka Chauhan.
Yeah.
Fossils are mostly found at which places?
Fossils are found in marine samples, in the brackish water related samples, and any kind of sample. For that matter, no, you have to see. As far as fossils are concerned, in India, you have got marine fossils in the Cretaceous of Trichinopoly area, and in the Jurassic of Kutch area, there are some fossil sites are there. And it depends. You are so working on microfossil or megafossil, and you get fossils in outcrops, not only in the outcrops, but also in the subcrops and in the bottom sediments. So like that, you know, fossils occur everywhere. Only thing is that environment, what kind of environment it was there, and there you will get the fossils.
Okay. So second question is from Star Stuff. Can micropaleontology be applied in case of Himalayas to establish its paleo environment? If so, which microfossil species can be used?
Yeah, microfossils are very much helpful in the orogenic activity. How this orogenic activity has taken place, and the, if you see the upliftment or the orogenic activity of Himalayas in five phases, the orogeny has taken place in five phases. The orogeny of Himalaya has taken place, and earlier it was a flat, then rupture, and it has developed, and then gorges have formed, and then freshwater valleys and deposition has taken place. It was a Tethys Sea, and Tethys Sea got closed because of the African plate and collided with the Europe, and the Indian subcontinent collided with the Europe. Eurasian plate. So because of these things, you know, when you have the marine environment, you get marine fossils, and these marine fossils of what age, and as the upliftment takes place, and subsequently at the bottom, you will get the older age forms. So like that, by studying these activities, you know, we can find out the orogenic or mountain building activity, and particularly the microfossils. People are working there. Our Wardia Institute of Himalayan Geology, they are doing extensive work there, and other Punjab University and Lucknow University people, they are all doing good work there as far as the orogeny of Himalayas.
Sir, next question is from Sayyed Yatif. He wants to know that whether recent ostracods are found in Karewas formation.
No. Karewas, they are the Pleistocene age. Recent ostracods means the ostracods which are present live in the recent sediments, recent marine sediments, recent river sediments, or recent estuarine sediments. But Karewas, they are the Pleistocene age. In Karewas, no, you don't get recent ostracods.
Next question is from Odisha. This is Urja Swati Mishra is asking, how many linking fossils are known to us till date, and can you please inform about some?
Linking fossils means, as I told you, Archaeopteryx. Archaeopteryx is a linking fossil between dinosaurs and birds. And like that, you know, if you do a detailed research work in different groups of mega as well as microfossils, there will be a linkage. There will be a linkage. That linkage can be found out.
Next question is of her only. How are the index fossils decided for a reason? She wants to know the criteria.
Criteria, index fossils particularly, they are helpful in the biostratigraphy. Particularly, as I told you earlier, index fossils are nothing but which have a short range in time, a narrow range in time, and they might have distributed worldwide. Worldwide geographical distribution and narrow stratigraphical range. Those forms are called as index fossils. With the help of the index fossils, we can find out the biozones, and these biozones will have a particular specific time range, and with the help of the time range, we can find out the age of the sediments.
Soham Banerjee from Presidency University, West Bengal, is asking, how can the paleoclimatic patterns be determined from biostratigraphic studies?
No, biostratigraphy is a different study. Paleoenvironment is a different study. So biostratigraphy is done with the help of the index fossils. Biozones are established and age can be identified. Paleoenvironment is nothing but with the help of the benthic forms particularly. And these forms will have a paleoecological implication. The environment in which it lives and what kind of environment it was, and that kind of implication, that kind of interpretation is paleoenvironment. So paleoenvironment is a different aspect, biostratigraphy is a different aspect.
Okay, so next is from Raj Kumar. He is working with Upper Cretaceous Microfossils Association that consists of ostracods and foraminifera, and his source material is sandstone and marl limestone. Was disintegrated in water with 30% of hydrogen peroxide. The problem is that microfossils are not totally liberated from the rock and still have pieces of it attached to their carapaces and testes. Please give me some hints on how to remove unwanted materials.
Okay, he is working on Cretaceous of which area?
Upper Cretaceous, yes.
No, Upper Cretaceous, that is age, area.
Yes, he have not mentioned the area.
Okay.
He has given the source material sandstone and limestone.
Yeah, yeah. So generally, these Cretaceous are older foraminifers and ostracods, you know, they are very, very hard to retrieve them from those particular sediments. In order to retrieve them, you have to apply hydrogen peroxide and soak for few hours, or otherwise, you know, sometimes, you know, if it is too highly consolidated sediments, then you have to add glacial acetic acid. Otherwise, you know, before adding glacial acetic acid, you have to add hexametaphosphate, sodium hexametaphosphate, and soak for few hours, 6 to 8 hours. Or otherwise, if needed, you know, you have to heat it and cool it, heat it and cool it. You have to repeatedly do it, and then by disintegration takes place. And if it is not disintegrated even after that, then you have to add glacial acetic acid with 10% with a low percentage. If you add more high percentage, glacial acetic acid, you know, acid acts over the calcareous foraminifera and ostracoda, then he will lose all microfossils. So for that, you know, he has to be very careful. He should care his with proper care. He has to apply the glacial acetic acid, feeble acetic acid, not the concentrated one.
Yes. So next question is from Lord Lena from Philippines. How do we find fossils when they have been buried under millions of layer worth of rock? And also wants to know, why do fossils come in so many colors?
No, can you repeat the question once again?
How do we find fossils when they have been buried under millions of air worth of rock?
Okay.
And why do fossils come in so many colors?
Well, because, you know, as I told you, the organisms, they lived in the geological past from the Cambrian onwards, and even certain spores and pollen grains and other thing, I mean acritars and other thing, even in the Precambrian sediments are also they originated, their origin has taken place that during that time, and because their origin is dated back to the older age, they are found to occur in the different sediments. And why they are occurring in different colors means, as the past environment changes, accordingly the color of the fossils keep changing. The color of the organisms of the fossils keep changing. It reflects on the environment in which it lived.
Okay, sir. So next question is from Soham Banerjee, Presidency University, West Bengal. How can we predict abbreviations in geochemical data in our study of rock of a particular period by using the microfossils of particular period? How can we predict abbreviations in geochemical data?
Every?
In our study of Aberrations. He has written aberration. Sir, you can see the question in chat section.
Chat section. Where it is chat section?
Sir, near the people 7. It is showing in upper upside. Just on left side of the time, sir.
Full screen.
Right hand side upper portion, sir.
Right hand side. You are presenting. Okay, that is there.
Yes. And there is a message option with green dot.
Turn on caption, sir.
No. Sir, on right upper side, sir.
Upper side. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Chat box.
With green dot. Yes, sir.
I got it. Yeah. Tell me where.
Sir, please come to question by PPSS. Please scroll up.
Scroll up. Okay.
So more
still.
So this one.
Where?
How can we predict?
How can the paleoclimate patterns, sir? Not that one.
Yes, sir.
How can the paleoclimatic patterns be determined from?
No. Sir, not this one. You will have to scroll down a little.
Okay. Yes. How can
aberrations
in geological data in our study of rocks of a particular period by using microclimate of that particular? Okay. Geochemical data, you know. So these fossils, when they are preserved, what kind of the sediment geochemistry is present in that? When you do the geochemical analysis of these microfossils and also the isotopic studies, and you can find out through the isotopes or otherwise through some trace element geochemistry of these microfossils, we can find out.
So next question is by DK Langini. He wants to know application of fossils in pollution monitoring.
Yeah, which I have already explained. Pollution monitoring, you have to frequently, periodically collect the samples along the coast or along the river beds, and then where the industries are located, and then you have to monitor the diversity, biodiversity of that particular organism, or otherwise you have to collect a core sample, and this core sample has to be analyzed geochemically. What kind of trace element is present, whether it is a cadmium, cobalt, nickel, zinc, this type of pollution is present. And also you have to date these core samples. When you date these core samples, you can tell hundreds of years ago or tens of years ago or a few years ago, this particular environment got polluted. And periodical sample collection and the core collection is needed.
So next question is from Kavita. She wants to ask, fossils always tell about past. Is it any possibility that they can guess about future also?
Yes. Good question. And the principle of uniformitarianism tells that present is key to the past. So past and present will tell you about the future. Past and present will tell you about the future. When you get the past information with the help of the fossils, present is known. By studying the past events and the present thing, you can forecast the future. You can tell about the future. You can guess.
So next question is from Arun Joshi. Why do usually some fossils, mainly plant megafossils, are dominant at certain vicinity in the continuous deposition sequence or environment? And how does it helpful to predict the paleoecology of area?
It is mainly reflecting to the environment in which they lived. Megafossils, you know, they have got certain constraints. They will not tell you more about the environment, and they have got some constraint. Whereas in case of microfossils, that can be very well ascertained.
So next question is from Nambi Rajan. Is there any volcanic activity during the period from Permian to Silurian in India?
Is there any volcanic activity during the period from Permian to Silurian in India? I don't think so. no volcanic activity.
Next question is from Lord Lena. What can fossils tell us?
Fossil will tell us a lot of things about the environment, about the age, about the we can find out the pollution. You can also tell about the hydrocarbon potential. You can also tell about the paleo tsunami and storm surges, and several applications are there.
Eric wants to know something about coral polyps and formation of atolls.
Yeah, if you have the expertise on coral studies, you know, you can tell about the formation of atolls. As such, you know, I don't know much about the formation of atolls. Atolls, you know, coral related this thing only. But I'm sorry, I'm not able to tell much about this thing. Why? Because I'm not a coral expert. I am an astronaut expert.
Yes. Sir, Fawaz Ahmed wants to know the correct age of Deccan traps.
Deccan traps, you know, the late Cretaceous and the early Eocene. That is the age, and still ambiguity is there when the Deccan eruption has started, and in terms of million years, there is slight variation is there. Late Cretaceous and the early Eocene time, that is the age.
So next question is by Star Stuff. Does microfossils have better preservation potential than macrofossils?
Certainly microfossils have better preservation potential than macrofossils.
Next question is by Nambi Rajan. During the movement of Indian subcontinent, then what happened to the Lemuria?
Movement of the, as the Indian subcontinent, it got fragmented from the Gondwana land, and prior to that Lemuria was there. Lemuria was not existed during that Permian time. It is the old terminology.
Next question is by Soham Banerjee. Can all the growth stages of ostracods be preserved in rock records?
No, all growth stages are not preserved, and why? Because you know, juveniles, you know, they have the chance of disintegration, or they get destroyed. So all the growth stages of fossils of ostracods, rarely you get preservation. Preservation will be there. You do get growth stages of fossils, but not all the growth stages.
So next question is by Anand Rajuria. How to differentiate between male and female form of planktonic foraminifera?
Actually, the foraminifers, you know, you have the dimorphism, but not male and female. There it is megalospheric and microspheric. Megalospheric forms means larger prolactin, smaller test. Microspheric is smaller prolactin, larger test. Like that only. But unlike the ostracoda, foraminifera, you don't have males and females.
Next question is by Soham Banerjee. How are the preservation conditions of urohaline and stenohaline species of ostracods different, and how it is related to their ornamentation?
Preservation of urohaline means they are the marine environment. The marine environment among which the shallow marine forms, they get preserved rarely. They get preserved, but when you compare to the stenohaline species, you know, their preservation differs. It differs mainly based upon the environmental conditions exist there. The type of the current movement, the type of the sediment deposition, and the type of the substrate, and the type of the ostracod species also, whether it is highly ornamented form or moderately ornamented form, accordingly the preservation differs.
So next question is by Star Stuff. Can taphonomy give us an idea about condition of environmental factors prevalent during the preservation of ancient fossils compared to modern fossils?
Certainly. Taphonomy is nothing but the process of preservation of fossils from its death stage to the till it becomes fossilized. So what kind of parameters, ecological parameters and other parameters like preservance or corrosion or the movement or turbulence, and then all these parameters, they play a role in the environmental conditions, thereby the preservation of ancient fossils with that of the modern fossil, it differs.
Next question is by Noli Vargal Kirit. Is there effect of global warming to carapace and open wall?
Yeah, global warming, no, global, it is not related to the global warming. It is related to the relative rate of sedimentation. The carapace and open walls, so the more carapaces you will get, the where you have a rapid rate of sedimentation. And open walls, you will get less rate of sedimentation or slow rate of sedimentation, not with reference to global warming.
So Soham Banerjee wants to know the effect of seismic wave and chemical pollution on carapaces.
Seismic wave. Seismic waves means it is a high impact of earthquake thing. And then, see, in a basin, when it gets as the fossil, as the organism in the process of preservation, thick pile of sedimentation takes place. In the seismic geological event, this type of thing takes place, you know, the preserved form, it gets deformed, it gets disturbed. Similarly, the case of chemical pollution, when the chemical pollution takes place on the carapace, it gets corroded, and then the proper preservation and good preservation you will not get. And you got my point. When the chemical pollution is there, the carapace gets corroded. Corrosion on the carapace takes place. When the seismic waves is there, the carapace gets deformed. It gets disturbed or damaged.
Okay. The next question is by Yugan Pandya. Yes, sir. Yugan Pandya, he is asking that throw some light on the microfossils of Jurassic of Kutch.
Yeah, Jurassic of Kutch is an area where it is actually considered as a very good site for the microfossil study. And here, people have worked on ostracods, foraminifers, and other kinds of activities of that Kutch basin. S.K. Biswas, Professor S.C. Khosla, and then Abu Talib, and many people, and Professor P.K. Saraswati from IIT Mumbai. They have done a lot of work on Kutch sediments, Jurassic of Kutch sediments. And then a lot of information is available. And with regard to the foraminifera also, and with regard to ostracods also, with regard to other group of also, the lot of microfossil data is available. Only thing is the candidate has to see the literature, the previous literature he has to search.
Thank you, sir. It looks like we have covered all our questions. Sir, is there anything you want to cover up before we wrap up?
Nothing. I have given a clear overall insight about what are fossils and how the megafossils are helpful, and then what are the various groups of microfossils, and then among which ostracods, how they play a role on the environment, and also to find out the hydrocarbon potentiality of the sediments. And what are the other, even also in the, in to find out the paleo-tsunami deposits. And with the case studies, I have explained to you. And I think I have clarified most of the questions, all the questions posed by the participants. Hope this lecture will be much helpful to them. And any clarification, if they need, you know, they can ask me through my email ID. And this type of webinars are really helpful for the students. I appreciate Mr. Ajay. And Shubham for organizing and coordinating in conducting this type of webinars. Particularly the Fossil International Fossil Day is going on, and so I'm happy that I could participate and I would be part of this particular program, and hope my lecture is much helpful to the participants. And further, if you have any queries, you know, you can refer to my email ID and you can ask me through mail. And you can also see my personal webpage, and there you have got plenty of ostracoda papers published by me. And not only that, I worked mostly on recent astropods. And fossil astropod study is being carried out by Professor Asik Khosla, M.L. Lagori, and the Guha, as I told you, Guha, and then other people have also worked. U.B. Mallikarjun and other thing from Bangalore. And there are some people who have worked on the fossil forms. And of course, you need to have the ecological database. The ecological, recent ecological database. And once you have the ecological database, that can be extrapolated to the fossil forms. And then you can interpret the belly environment of the older sediments. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir, for your knowledgeable talk. And also thank you to accept our invitation for the talk. This talk is very valuable for every student. We got various comments related to webinar. Many persons said that the webinar is very good and the talk is also very good. So at the end of the webinar, we also thank Mr. Pranay Diwate for helping us related to technical issues. And because when he helps us due to his help, we conducted this webinar. So the Team Geovigyan thanks Mr. Pranay Diwate for his help. And Team Geovigyan also thanks to Professor Hussain for his valuable time and a valuable talk. So now we are ending the webinar. Thank you all participants for participating in this webinar. Thank you all.
Okay, wish you all the best. God bless you.
Thank you, sir.